And let's go. Okay, so the first thing, of course, is we have again the chat option. I already see the first question here. So if you have questions, write them into the chat box and I will monitor throughout the class. It says here, does the email we have associated with Zoom have to be the same email we have associated with on Learning Suite in order to get participation points? Don't worry about the participation points. That is something that is not properly configured at this point anyway. Okay, so let's start talking about lecture 24. First, review from last time. Not review. First, the very important things. We discussed last time that we wanted to explore the idea of dropping midterm 2, and after the feedback from the first and second section, I decided to do so. Dropping midterm 2 results though in 30% of the class grade no longer being assigned through that midterm, so I have to spread these 30% out. The first thing I want to do is remind you of how the original grading scheme was set up. Originally, you were supposed to get 20% of your final grade from participating in the teaching challenge on the video production. And you got a quarter of the points for submitting the first video, a quarter of the points for review, peer review, and a quarter of the points is attributed to submitting the final video by the 5th of April to the Dropbox folder. In the past, we also said 12.5% will be awarded to you based on the review you get from your peers. And it will sort of consider the five randomly assigned peer review responses and then your own assessment of your work. What I'm going to do now is I'm going to reduce this to not being graded. This is just going to be participation points. So if you do your five peer reviews, then you are going to get the 12.5% for final class for participation in the teaching challenge or the video challenge. Those randomly assigned topics will be assigned as soon as all of the videos are uploaded to YouTube. I assume that going to be the case the Monday after the deadline, so like the 6th or 7th of April. It depends on how quickly I can get all these movies uploaded. You can see it's quite a few. About 340 are expected. Many of those are like almost a gigabyte large. So it just takes time to physically move these files around. So once they're all uploaded though, I will distribute the links and they will be completely randomly assigned this time. I assume that everyone is now familiar with the topics covered in class. So you can review pretty much anything that is taught by one of your colleagues, and you should be able to give intelligible comments on the quality of the teaching. Okay, so that's sort of what was there before. And now how do we going to spread out the additional 30%? I want to give an additional 20% of your grade for a new assignment, which I call self-reflection and evaluation. This will take place after the peer review has been received. After you have received the peer review from your colleagues, I want you to write a report of about 2 pages answering the following questions. What did you learn from reviewing your midterm class evaluations and the videos that you reviewed from your peers? I assume that there was some learning that took place. Either a student gave you a peer review and made some good comments about what you could improve or do better, or maybe you watched a video where you thought, oh, well, this is a nice technique. This is something that looks cool and I could learn or incorporate that. Okay, I want you to reflect on this. Then I want you to answer the question, how did you incorporate this learning into improving your final video? I assume that your final video is better than your midterm video, and I want you to explain what you did to improve. And then finally, I want you to summarize how your peers have evaluated your final video. Okay, so that is kind of like writing a few paragraphs to each of these questions. After you have done this, you will submit this report to the grading email, and then you will go on Max, and you will, based on your assessment, give yourself the final grade that represents best the quality of your work. This means after you've had chance to reflect on how much effort you spent on improving your midterm videos and how much you cared about doing this good and how much you attribute or how much you value the opinion of the students that reviewed your final work, you are going to give yourself the grade that you think you deserve. Well, maybe that's the wrong way to phrase it. Not the grade that you think that you deserve, but you will give yourself the grade that you think represents the quality of your work. Okay, so I want you to go through this process of being your own judges, because I think at the end of this life, we are all going to be our own judges, and we have to get sometimes the experience of what it means to reflect upon our own actions and put them into contrast to our abilities, our possibilities, and also what people around us did and how it compares with that. But not everything has to always be graded externally. Lots of things can be graded internally. And I think this will be an opportunity for you to get an experience with this. So just to make it clear, the final grade that you will get is going to be self-assigned, but you will also report on this self-reflection and evaluation process that led you to the decision of which grade you assigned yourself. Okay, so this is going to take care of 20% of your grade. The remaining 10% are split up the following. Based on the feedback that I got last section, I kind of feel that it's right to reweight the homework problems. Lots of you have spent a substantial amount of time on the homeworks, so I will raise them from 10% to 18%. And the other 2% I will award to those who fill out the end of class survey, which will open next week. And I'll give you some more details on that next week when it's there. All right, let's look at the chat. There are a couple of questions there. Were we supposed to do a peer review for our own first video as well, or is it just for the second peer review? Well, you sort of should have done it for your own as well. I didn't spell it out like that you had to write out a paper, but what you were supposed to do is you were supposed to reflect after the first midterm, the first video submission, and think about what things you could improve. And so I assume that now that you have a final video, between the first video and the second video, there was some type of reflection ongoing where you thought about your video, where you looked at what your peers said, and then you said, okay, these are the things that I can improve and make better. So, yes. Hey, here's again my favorite question that I got in the first section that made me really mad. Now I got it twice. And is it single or double spaced? This whole idea here, the spirit of this is an exercise of self-reflection and self-evaluation. Okay? I'm going to give you some basic guidelines about 2 pages. I'm not saying here's a rubric of how you can jump over this hurdle to get your credits. I'm saying here's an opportunity for you to consider and learn and make an experience that you might not have had before. And all of the grades that are going to be assigned are completely self-assigned. So if you want to write half of a page and you think this is a work that deserves an A, then you might suffer from a misconception. If you think that writing 100 pages is getting you more likely to get an A, then that might also not be quite accurate. If you write between 1.5 and 2.5 pages, single, double spaced, I don't care, and you feel that is the amount of space that you need to hold down your thoughts and your reflections, then this is exactly what I'm aiming for. I'm giving you a rough number here, not to set a minimum threshold that you have to jump over, but just to gauge what I consider to be about the amount of words that are necessary to do a meaningful reflection on something like such a video. When I reflect on my lectures and think about what I can improve and do better, I typically write about a page on a document, sometimes 2. You have the advantage of giving peer review as well, and so you can incorporate that, which makes it a little bit longer. But this is really an opportunity for you to spend time considering, thinking, and reflecting instead of cramming for something or meeting minimum requirements. So please, no more questions about single or double spaced. this is supposed to be something that gives you an opportunity to reflect and hold down these thoughts. And though I want to see that report, just so that you feel at least a little bit responsibility about this, I'm not going to go through it and count the lines. Okay, then are all of the homework assignments being reweighted or just remaining ones? No, I'm going to reassign just a new percentage to all of the homeworks. So before they were 10%, now they're going to be worth 18%, also retrospectively. Oh, apparently someone already got an email this morning with access to the end of semester survey and you already filled it out today. Well, good. Then that would be the same survey. I thought it only opens next week. Okay, and it says here on the syllabus, it says that the two lowest homeworks are dropped, that they are not dropped on max like the iClicker questions are. Will they still be dropped? And if it says so in the syllabus, then yes. You can assume that the final grades will be available once the semester is over and I have everything gathered together. So the current scores on max, I think, are a good indication of where people stand. But you're probably a little bit better than what Max currently suggests, because some of the iClicker scores haven't been updated yet, and these homeworks haven't been taken out of the calculation. All right, so this seems to be all the questions that were there. With that being said, let's jump into the lecture. Last time we talked about the atom and what it is made of. We learned that it has a nucleus that consists of protons and neutrons, and then the electrons that are somehow orbiting around it. And there were some problems with that model that were not able to be explained until Niels Bohr came along and suggested that we could quantize things. And when he started to quantize the angular momentum of the electrons, then all of a sudden it was possible to calculate the amount of energy that electrons were allowed to have. And by looking at this amount of energy, it was now all of a sudden possible to explain why we had absorption and emission spectra in atoms. The core formula that helps us to assign energy to electron orbits is given up here. It's this very simple equation where you just plug in. So if you want to know the energy at a state n, you just take this number, minus 13.6 electrovolt, and divide it by whatever state you are in, like 1, 2, or 3. You square that and then divide it. So in this model, we are sort of drawing our nucleus at the center, and we're saying electrons are living on orbits around it. And there is a certain amount of energy difference between states. And when an electron jumps, for example, from a high energy state, like the n equals 3, down to a lower energy state, like n equals 2, the energy that it loses while jumping down is being emitted in form of a photon. So every time an electron jumps down, it loses energy, and the energy that it loses is given off. Before, we have often seen that energy is given off in form of heat. In this case, we are not talking about energy being given off in form of heat, but rather in forms of light or photons. The opposite process also occurs. That's called absorption. That is when an electron on a lower energy level gets hit by a photon that has exactly the right energy to get it excited into a higher energy state. And so when a photon hits this electron with exactly the right amount of energy, it jumps to a higher energy state on higher orbit. So that was pretty much what we learned about the hydrogen model and Bohr's approximations to it. That model has some great successes, but also limitations. So what the Bohr model gets right is that angular momentum and energy levels are quantized. And that's something that was completely shocking before, since quantum mechanics wasn't really developed, but it really explained the measurements that were done at that point really well, especially the atomic spectra. So being able to now predict the correct spectral lines for hydrogen and hydrogen-like atoms, that was a big leap forward. And it even provided some rationale why the electrons could not spiral into the nucleus. because all of a sudden it wasn't possible anymore for an electron to give off all of its energy. It had to have a minimum amount of energy, which forced it to be on this large orbit, and it could no longer be existent in the center of the nucleus, given the energies that Bohr predicted to be accurate. The other thing that we get from this is we can calculate the orbits of the electrons based on this angular momentum. And so we can get a good approximation for the size of the hydrogen atom. We learned last time that the size of the atom is, an atom is mainly consists out of empty space. In the center, you have this tiny, tiny nucleus, but then about 100 million times larger is the size of the atom actually, which is defined by the outermost orbit of the electrons. So all of that was well explained with the Bohr model, but then there were some things that just got wrong. It's mainly wrong because it is not an exact solution. It is more or less an approximation to what would be developed like in the 1920s, which we call the real quantum mechanics. So it was sort of like the bridging thing between the classical world where we thought about electrons and protons being particles into this world where things have to adhere to some types of quantization rules. But it didn't really incorporate yet the full wave-like nature of things. What it also didn't get right was the value of angular momentum in each energy level. And while probably the biggest problem is that it defines an actual radius to of an orbit on which the electron is supposed to live. But we know now that electrons don't live on an orbit. They are living in like a probability cloud in quantum mechanics where we can't really say where they are. We just kind of know where they could be. And these probability clouds, they are what you learn about in your chemistry classes when you see the S, the D, and the P orbitals. And one of the biggest limitations is the Bohr model only works if you have hydrogen-like atoms. And hydrogen-like atom is an atom that has only one electron. And so as soon as you have more electrons, this whole thing breaks down and you don't get the right predictions. So in summary, this model was a really crucial step to develop us towards quantum mechanics, but it wasn't by far a complete treatment of the whole periodic table and everything we see there. Everything else that had to come still took a few decades afterwards. So there's a question here. What does this mean for the models we use in chemistry class? Very good question. Probably learning outcome for today. By the end of today, you should be able to understand what these models in chemistry mean. What do shells and orbitals mean, and what do they have to do with quantum mechanics? So I hope you will be able to answer this question by the end of this lecture. All right. So here first, what you can see is this chemistry-like picture where we have density clouds in which electrons live. So here, for example, are the S orbitals, the P orbitals, and the D orbitals. And you can see that they're sometimes shown as these donuts or circles, and then you have these spheres and then these dumbbell shapes. And those are probably the type of orbits that you've seen in some of your chemistry classes. These guys here are the solutions to the Schrödinger equation that I've shown once quickly to you in an earlier class. The Schrödinger equation is really what you need in order to solve for the wave-like behavior of electrons. So we said that these psi's here, they represent waves, probability waves. And if you solve this equation for the hydrogen atom, for example, what you get out is like this three-dimensional shape of a probability wave in which the electrons can exist. And one thing you can see here as well are these little numbers like 200, 300, 310. These numbers here are quantum numbers that we're going to explore in this lecture today as well. And they help us to define if something is an S orbital, in a B orbital, in a D orbital, or whatever. So that will be definitely more covered in the rest of this lecture. One thing that I want to point out is before we have called the electrons we said that the electrons live on orbits. They're kind of orbiting. In quantum mechanics, we don't talk about orbits because they sort of assume this planetary-like motion where you have a particle flying on this nice ellipse around the center. Instead, we're talking about orbitals. And orbitals are these probability clouds, these fluffy things in which an electron is somewhere to be found. We don't know exactly where it is. We just know it's somewhere inside of this orbital volume. Okay, so that's just some words. But now let's go into the physics of it. First, a little bit of a review example here. What we're looking at here is the example of an electron that lives on the n equals one level. So it lives on a low energy level. And we are wondering what type of photon do we have to send in order to kick it up to a higher energy state. So we have the electron living on this lower state. And now we want to send in maybe some green light. This green light hits the electron, and the electron now jumps up to the higher state. Now, in order to make this transition, the photon that comes in, the light, has to give the electron exactly the amount of energy that is necessary to jump from the lower state into the higher state. So what is this amount of energy? It's going to be delta E. And delta E is the energy difference between my initial state and my final state. So the energy in state n equals 1, according to Bohr's formula, is minus 13.6 electrovolt divided by 1 to the square, which is just minus 13.6 electrovolts. And now from this, I have to subtract the energy of the second state, which is minus 13.6 electrovolt divided by 2 to the square, or divided by 4. If I divide 13.6 by 4, I get something on the order of minus 3.4 electrovolts. Now I have two minus signs here. That turns into a plus. So the result is going to be minus 10.2 electrovolts. Why is there a negative sign? The negative sign tells me that it costs me energy to jump from here to here. Somewhere, someone has to come along and give me the energy that is necessary to jump from here to here. In this case, the photon is the one that brings the energy. So let's ask ourselves, how much energy does the photon have in order to make this possible? So what's the energy of the photon? The energy of the photon must be exactly this value, but it's the energy that's going to be brought in, so it's the positive value. So the energy is going to be 10.2 electrovolts. But what does this mean in terms of wavelength? We are asking here about the wavelength of this photon. Well, we know that the energy of a photon is given by h times f, the Planck's constant multiplied by the frequency of the light. And we know that c, the speed of light, is always given by the frequency of the electromagnetic wave multiplied by its wavelength. Okay, so if I solve this guy here for f and plug it in, I'm going to get h times if I solve this for f, then I get f equals c over lambda. So I have h times c over lambda. And I can now solve this equation for lambda and say lambda equals h times c divided by 10.2 electrovolts. Now h is this terrible small number, like 9 times 10 to the power minus 34. And c is like 3 times 10 to the power 8 meters per second. H times c is a constant that you can look up. It's frequently used for these types of problems. I forget the concrete value. But the number that you get out of this, if you divide that by 10.2 electrovolts, you get a wavelength of 121 nanometers. So it's not quite green light. It's a lower it has a little bit more energy than that. It's a shorter wavelength than green light. But that is the way how you would go about calculating what type of light you need in order to kick an electron from a low energy state to a higher energy state. And since we're going to do this for quite a bit in this lecture, I thought it's worthwhile to run once through an example of it. Okay, let's see. Any questions? Nothing yet. Then let's keep going. So what are some applications of this excitations and de-excitations? The first one, and some of you that were early enough here have seen the video, is called fluorescence. Fluorescence is a phenomenon that we observe when electrons instantly or very rapidly on the nanosecond scale jump from an excited state back into the ground state. So examples are for here like the scorpion that is looked at with UV light. When you send UV light at the scorpion, it gives off a different type of fluorescent light and you can see it easier and probably avoid it. Or here you have this nice brain in a bottle. I don't know what it is, but it's green fluorescent. So if you shine this ultraviolet bluish light at it, it's going to fluoresce and show you green light. A real life example that you probably have used multiple times is a highlighter, a text marker. If you have one of these green fluorescent text markers, inside of these materials, there's a dye, like a little molecule, that is able to interact with normal light that is around and go through the process of fluorescence. And what this process of fluorescence is shown in this graphic here, where I have shown you the different energy states that might exist inside of one of these dyes, one of these fluorescent molecules, where electrons can be either on a ground state, on an excited state, or on a little bit higher energy state. It's like a called S1 prime here. It's kind of like a state that's a bit higher than the excited state, but it's not a huge energy difference between these two. Okay, so what happens in fluorescent material is all the electrons are by default on the ground state because everything likes to be at the lowest energy possible. But now some energy is being put in. We throw some light at this. So for example, some light that comes in is blue light, high energy light, like in this example. This blue light comes in, it interacts with the electrons and kicks them up to a higher energy level. When the electrons are at this high energy level, they want to come down, because the ground state is where nature tends to stick around. So they want to come down. Initially, they're just going to jump down to the excited state level as one through some vibrations inside of the molecule. Nothing fancy here. There's a small energy difference. It's more or less vibrational motion makes them jump down. And the energy difference from here to here is so small that the electromagnetic wave that would be given off is forgettable small. We don't care about that. But then the difference from the excited state to the ground state starts to play a role, because now in a matter of nanoseconds, this excited electron will jump down from the excited state into the ground state. And as it does so, the difference between the excited state and ground state in terms of energy is released in form of a photon. You can see that this photon that is coming out has a larger wavelength than this incoming photon, which means that this one has lower energy than this one. So while it took you blue light to excite these electrons to jump up, you're now getting lower energy light, like green light, to come out. And this is exactly what you see in this fluorescent experiment. We are sending in ultraviolet or blue light. This blue light is absorbed by the material inside of the bottle. There's some vibrations and stuff going on that we don't see. But then all of the electrons inside of this probably green fluorescent protein here are jumping from the excited state down to the ground state. And it's always exactly the same energy jump. And because it's exactly the same energy jump, the color that we get out is looking the same everywhere. It's just like this greenish color that corresponds exactly to the wavelength that that a photon has to have to compensate for the loss in energy between the excited and the ground state. All right, so that's the basic idea of fluorescence. We excite electrons and they instantly fall down into a lower state. And so when you have the highlighter and go over paper, you see that it looks like fluorescent yellow, for example, that is because from the white ambient light that is all around you in the room, the high energy light, like the blue and the ultraviolet, probably mainly the violet light and the blue light, is absorbed and then re-emitted into your eyes in forms of green light, lower energy. And so it's able to absorb all of the higher higher frequencies and then only emit a certain amount of it back to you. And therefore we can use text markers with different colors that have a different emission spectrum. It also might give you a good feeling why we like to use yellow instead of blue, because it's kind of hard to get a blue text marker because you would have to send light in that has a higher energy than the blue light. And there's not that much around in the normal light that we have on the inside of the house. Outside, when you have the sun and you have actual UV light, then you could do that. But in the inside of the house, it's easier to work with red, orange, yellow, and green highlighters. There's one question here. See, does every element fluoresce to a point, but certain materials fluoresce visible to the human eye? So fluorescence is typically defined for a material that has an energy difference between an excited state and ground state that corresponds to a wavelength that we can see with our eyes. So if you want to talk in general about electrons jumping from a higher state into a lower state, yes, that's happening all the time with every material, but not every material has an energy gap that corresponds to a photon that is detectable by our eyes. So typically fluorescence, we like to only call the events that are visible to us, while everything else is sort of the same principle, but fluorescence is sort of like the special case of energy differences being detectable by our eye. Alrighty, so that's fluorescence. The next thing is called phosphorescence. So while fluorescence was the instant decay of electrons, phosphorescence is the delayed decay or delayed de-excitation. And what I mean with this is shown in this graphic here. Here are two electrons shown in two different states. This one here is in a lower energy state. Here's energy on the y-axis, lower energy state than this one. Because this was in a lower energy state, we can call this a ground state. This state over here, what should we call this? This is not the ground state, because this electron would be way better off being down here at the lower energy, but it can't get there because there's this barrier in the way. It's kind of like the ball being trapped on the mountain with like slope on both ends. It just can't get to the bottom unless you kind of kick it. And so because this guy is stuck in a state that he doesn't like to be in, it's not his ideal state, but it is a state that is sort of prevents him from escaping due to barriers. We call this a metastable state. So it's somewhat stable. In a moment, I would go ahead and give this electron a kick that's strong enough to get him over here, then it would just roll down and be in a really stable state and lose its energy on the way. But if I don't put energy in, then the electron is going to sit there indefinitely because there's nothing that can make it move. And so phosphorescence is the basic idea that some material does have energy states that are accessible. So you can excite an electron from the stable state into this higher energy state. They're accessible to get them in there. But once you have the electron sit here, it's not easy for them to jump down right away. In the case of fluorescence, they were able to jump down right away. It was kind of like moving them up on a slope and then they would just roll down. There was no energy barrier in the way. But with metastable states, there's this energy barrier, so something has to happen for them to come down. So when they're stuck in such a global minimum, such a local minimum in a metastable state, then they can stay there for quite a long time. And this can be used, for example, in the application called photo dating. And I don't mean Tinder with this. I mean with this, the ability to look at old material and tell how old the stuff really is. So in the case of this Chinese ceramic figure, we are able to identify how old the material is by taking a small sample of it and throwing it into an oven. Because what you do when you take a material and make ceramic out of it is you put a lot of heat into it. And while you do so, you're exciting some of the atoms while making this stuff. And the atoms that are inside, they're getting excited. So some of the stable electrons are jumping into metastable states. And then as you cool this material down, they kind of get locked in the metastable state. And if you now go ahead and warm up the sample, then all of a sudden this metastable state starts to vibrate and whoop, the electron all of a sudden jumps down into the lower state. As it does so, it loses energy, and the energy it loses is being given off in forms of a photon. So by putting in heat or thermo, we're getting out photons or light, luminescence. So the process called thermoluminescence means you take a piece of an old material, you put it in the oven, you warm it up, and you see what light comes out. The intensity of the light that comes out is directly correlated with the number of electrons that were still in the metastable state. And because these ceramics live for a long time and things happen to them, they get warm over time, they get moved around, there's a probability that electrons from a metastable state just sort of due to random noise for a stochastic process jumped out into the stable state. So the older the material is, the more of the metastable electrons have found their way already in a stable state. So by measuring how much intensity of light I get out of a warmed up piece of this material, I can quantify how many electrons were still in a metastable state. And if I have somewhere a lookup table where I can see how quickly they normally decay into stable states, I can say, oh, maybe this guy here is 3,000 years old. How old is this? 11th century, so it's like 1,000 years old. And you can apparently make very precise measurements with this technique. But then you can also have nice glow boards, glow-in-the-dark figures and posters. They kind of work under the same idea. You put a material into the sunlight, it kicks electrons from a stable into a metastable state, and then you put them in a dark room, and due to the temperature in your room, over time, electrons are jumping from the metastable into the stable state, and they're giving off this spooky green light. Now, that's just a different application that I would show you if you were in a classroom right now. Okay, a couple of questions here. Is fluorescence related to bioluminescence? Yes. If you define bioluminescence the same way that I do. So there's, for example, the green fluorescent protein or the yellow fluorescent proteins. And those are just proteins that are able to absorb light and give off light of a very specific color. And so, yeah, you can have fluorescence in a variety of materials. And sometimes you might call it bio. It just means it's fluorescence by a material that a biologist likes to deal with. So now someone says less intensity is proportional to more recent years. No. The more electrons I have in a metastable state, the more can jump down into the stable state, right? So when my material was freshly made, I have a lot of electrons in a metastable state, just freshly made. If I now take a piece of it and throw it in the oven, all of them jump down and I get the maximum amount of signal back, maximum amount of light and of intensity. If on the other hand, I have a piece of material that was made a long time ago, all the electrons jumped into the metastable state. Now, hundreds of years passed, lots of them have already decayed through random events. And then I take a sample and put it in the oven, I'm only going to get a very weak signal and light. So intensity, the higher the intensity, the newer the material. And then another question, do phosphorescence things eventually stop being so? If so, how long does it usually take? So the property of an atom to be able to jump its electrons from a lower state into a higher state, that is given by the composition of the molecule. If you have a very stable chemical molecule that doesn't decay, then it will stay phosphorescent for a long time. So I recently found some of my old childhood Legos when I was playing with my kids in the basement, and one of them was this little ghost. And this Lego ghost, and you held it under light, it was white and see-through, and then put it in their pocket, you could see that it would glow. It was phosphorescent. It still was so. So over the last, when did I stop playing with Legos? 20 years ago or so. Over the last 20 years, that phosphorescent was not lost. So I believe that if you don't do anything that breaks your molecules apart, you should still maintain that ability to store and give off light. All right, I think those were all the questions. And let's keep going. Let's start talking about how lasers work. Here's a short 1 minute video. I let him explain and then I re-explain.
To make a laser, all you need to do is give a big collection of atoms enough energy so they're excited and ready to emit light. Once one of them spontaneously emits a photon, it'll stimulate some of the others to do so, and you get a nice cascade of illumination. But instead of letting all the light escape, it's more powerful to trap it between two mirrors and let it bounce back and forth through the atoms. All that passing light will stimulate them to emit even more light, and as long as you keep on re-exciting the atoms, they're happy to go on emitting light forever. But why do the atoms emit light just because another photon passes by? It's actually pretty simple. Imagine flipping two coins. They can either be in the same state or in different states. But photons aren't like coins. No matter how hard you try, you can't tell one apart from another. So in a photon flipping experiment, that means there's only one way for them to be in different states, but two ways for them to be in the same state. So they're more likely to be in the same state. And in general, this implies that photons always want to be like other photons, to have the same phase, polarization, and go in the same direction. And what's more amazing is that if a solitary photon passes by an excited atom that could emit another photon, there's a good chance it will emit one, because the two photons want to be together, even before the second one exists. So once you have all these friendly photons bouncing around between the mirrors, you can just open up a little hole at the end and let out a blinding stream of coherent light, a laser beam. To see lasers in action, check out this sweet episode of Smarter. To make a laser.
I like these 1 minute physics videos. After I understood the concept, for learning a concept, they're sometimes a little bit too fast for me. Since you might feel the same way, let me re-explain. How do lasers work? Let's look at the basic example of having four atoms here. And those are all atoms that do have a metastable state. That is really essential. In order to build a laser, you need to find material that has a metastable state. It doesn't have to be phosphorescent. The energy difference can be different. But it has to have a metastable state. So what you do is when you have an atom with a metastable state, you send a photon in, and this photon is able to kick an electron either into the metastable state, as shown here, or into a higher energy state. Now these higher energy states, like the, what is this, first, second, third, fourth, the fourth one here or the second one here, they're not stable. That means kind of in the same as in the fluorescence case, these electrons are jumping instantly down. The transition from here to here goes instantly. And that's shown in this picture. They all jump down. And as they jump down to this state, they're emitting a little bit of light, but that's not really important. It's just a small portion of light that we don't care about. But what has happened here is going from this picture to this picture, all of the electrons that were originally in the ground state have now been pumped up into this metastable state. And this is now a high energy state. This is kind of the same idea as cocking your gun. You're having your gun and you put in potential energy, so you're ready to press the trigger and release it all. So the basic idea here is that once my electrons are in the first metastable state, I can send in a photon here, maybe this green light here. And as the photon travels along, it signals to the first atom, hey, if you drop your electron down, you could send out a photon as well. So let's travel together. And then I'm going to get two waves. And these two waves are passing this atom. And then this one is going to drop its electron down. And then I have now three photons traveling together. And they're all nicely behaved. They're all coherent, which means they're in phase. And they're monochromatic, which means they all have the same energy, same wavelength. So then this one falls down and then I get four and so on. Wow, now I can't draw anymore. And then when the last one falls down, now I have five waves that are coming out and they're all very nice, coherent waves of the same wavelength. And they kind of form like this laser light that can come out. So that's the basic idea. There is a FET demo that I wanted to show you as well. Let's see if I can. Let's keep these scribblings here. Where is it? Here. Reset all. Yes. So what we have here is a setup, and sorry for the resolution, I couldn't find a better one. We have this little tube here that has a gas in it. So it has these atoms that all have a one on them. They're floating in a gas. And up here, I have lamps. And these lamps I can turn on. And as I do so, I'm sending light through these atoms. And I can look at it either as like this beam of light, or I can say the light that comes out here, photons. Then they would look like this. I have to play it. And then the electrons are, the photons from the blue lamps, they're going in and they're able to interact with all of these atoms. Or I can just have the beam look. Now, what I can see also is, if I stop this for a second, I can control which wavelength my light has. I can make it red or I can make it blue. Red is giving it less energy. And you can see this in this plot. Here you see the three different states. One is the ground state, that is where the electrons typically are. Two is the metastable state, where they live for a long time. And three is now a state where they don't live for a long time. That's just an excited state. So if I change the wavelength here, the wavelength here, you can see that this energy changes, and by making it this large, I just give it enough energy so that electrons could jump from the ground state into the first excited state. If I make it a little bit more blue, go up to here, now I'm giving it enough energy so that a photon that comes in with this energy has enough energy to kick an electron from the ground state into the second state. So if I now press go, now I have all of these electrons come in, all of these photons come in. I can look again at the photons. The photons are coming in. Some of them are getting absorbed by the electrons and they kick the atoms into excited states. The blue rimmed ones, let's go back to this view. The blue rimmed ones are electrons that are in the second, in this blue state here, where it says free, so the second excited state. And the red ones, those are the ones that are holding on to their photons, to their electrons in the metastable state. Now this doesn't show look like a laser, right? I'm shooting blue light, high energy light in, and I'm getting out lower energy red light, and it bounces in all random directions. What I have to do to make this a laser is I have to put in some mirrors. By putting some mirrors in here, I allow some of the photons that are being emitted, the red ones, if they come orthogonal to the mirror, to bounce back and forth between the mirrors and never get lost. It's just light, it can bounce back and forth indefinitely. And as these red photons are bouncing back and forth, they're passing excited electrons, because the blue light consistently re-excites electrons. And as they're passing the excited electrons, they're saying, hey, come on, jump down into the ground state and give me your photon friend and I can take him along. And so over time, I'm capturing more and more of these electrons, more of these photons, and they're all bouncing right and left off the mirrors. And so what I'm doing here, I'm priming or pumping up the laser. And you can see down here how much power I'm saving in here. You can see how this goes up and up and up. So while I'm shooting blue light in, blue light gets converted into red light, but while the blue light was kind of like diffusing in all ways, so you can see here how the blue light just goes away and it's not very great, it just comes out of flashlights. The red light that I'm collecting between the mirrors has very, very high energy. I can also look at the amplitude of the light. So if I look at this picture, I can see that the red light here has this it's this nice wave. And because all of the photons in here are coherent and monochromatic, which means same wavelength and same frequency, they're all constructively interfering with each other. So every time I get a new photon, it adds a little bit to the amplitude of the commutative of the superposition or the sum of all of the waves. So as I start to get to higher and higher energies, I can see that the amplitude grows and grows. And so if I say now, hey, I charged up my laser and I want to do an experiment or shoot someone or whatever, I can just remove one of these mirrors. So let's do that. And then I have this big package of light traveling in both directions. Typically, we just remove one side. And so now if I would put the mirrors up again, I'd have to start again from the beginning and pump it up anew. And so this tells you why it's very rare that you see a continuous laser. Typically, a laser goes tick, 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 because it takes a while to pump up to get enough of these photons to be around. And then after it's been charged up, it releases them and shoots the laser pulse out. Some people might wonder why that doesn't happen to your laser pointer in a classroom. That's because the laser pointer is actually not a laser. It is just a diode that is engineered very well to make a bright beam of light, but it's not a real laser. Real lasers are cooler. We don't use them in classrooms because they might actually hurt. All right, so much about lasers. Let's go back here. Now we're gonna go into the last topic for today, the quantum numbers. So we've learned now a lot about electrons, and it's important to describe the state that they're in. But how do you actually do that accurately? What is like the real zip code of an electron? Which numbers do you need to describe its complete address? The things that you need to describe it are the so-called quantum numbers. And there are four of them. There's the principal quantum number, which just sort of states how much energy is around. Then there's the angular momentum of the electron. This is the thing that Niels Bohr proposed that would solve our problem of like the atomic spectra, saying that the angular momentum is quantized and doesn't come in arbitrary values. But then, as we will see in a little bit, there are also two other quantizations. And one of them is the direction of angular momentum, and the other one is the spin of the angular momentum. And when we understand all of these four, then we're able to explain the chemistry model of the periodic table. So let's jump into it. So first, the first principle, the principal quantum number, here's an intuition behind it. So we knew from Bohr that he came up with a more involved mathematical argument, but here's the one that is, I think, a little bit more accessible. So if you consider that electrons live on an orbit, if you consider that they live on the circle, then we can just ask ourselves the question, how does an electron living on the circle fit together with our view of quantum mechanics, where we say that a wave describes the electron? In order to understand the relationship, we can just take this circumference of this orbit by kind of cutting it here and just pulling it out into a straight line like this. And then we know that the length of this dashed line is the circumference. So it's 2 pi times r, 2 pi times the radius. And now if we want to have electrons live on this orbit, and electrons are waves, we must somehow make it possible that the waves that live on here are not going to be anywhat destructive in the interference. Otherwise, the electron would just pop out of existence. So we just propose that an electron that lives on this orbit must have a wavelength that can constructively interfere with itself, which means that the wavelength that fits on this circumference must start exactly here and end exactly here. So if I have a wavelength where my wavelength lambda is exactly equal to 2 pi times r, I would be able to fit exactly one wavelength of my electron on here. But now you can also make the argument and say, well, if I can fit one wavelength on here, could I also fit two? And well, there's no reason why not. We're just gonna use half of the wavelength of this guy, and then we're able to fit two wavelengths in here, and then they can still constructively interfere. And then you can do 3, 4, 5, however many you want. You just must be aware that every time you plug in an additional wavelength here, you are going to reduce the overall wavelength. and reducing the wavelength increases the energy of the electron. So if you want to have an electron live on this orbit that has like 26 wavelengths fit in here, that's going to be a very, very high energy. And so if you follow this argument, you can kind of see that you can either wrap one wavelength around the orbit, two, three, or four. And by getting this, we can derive this little equation here and say that the circumference 2 pi r is equal to how often I wrap my wavelength around, so n times pi. And I can solve this for lambda, n times lambda, and I can solve this for lambda. When I do this, I'm not solving this for lambda. What I'm saying is here, lambda is also defined as the de Broglie wavelength. So the de Broglie wavelength said that I just have to look at Planck's constant h and divide it by the momentum, m times v. That also gives me lambda. So now I have two equations, and I can plug this equation in for lambda here. And then I get 2 pi r equals n times h over mv. And if I do a little bit more algebra on this, and I bring the mv on this side and the 2 pi over on this side, I get r times m times v equals nh over 2 pi. What is rm times v? You might not remember, but in 105 you learned that that is L, the angular momentum. The angular momentum is r times m times v. And by following this simple derivation, we see now that our angular momentum is equal to n times constants. And these constants are sometimes summarized with this sign here, the h bar. L equals n times h bar. It says that angular momentum comes only in discrete values of h bar. It's very similar to the argument that we learned about last time from Planck, that photons only come in multiple values of this Planck's constant h. Similar, angular momentum comes only in multiples. All right, so because of this argument that electrons are waves and they have to fit around the orbit, we can say that angular momentum is quantized. Pops straight out of the basic idea that electrons are waves. Now, if we look at the atomic spectra, what we can see typically is these individual lines of absorption or emission, and they correspond very well to the quantization of momentum, of angular momentum. But only if you do the experiment in normal conditions in your classroom or whatever. If you look into the absorption spectrum in the presence of a magnetic field, so here it's a classroom, you don't have a magnetic field, but if you repeat the experiment and you put the atom that's absorbing stuff in a strong magnetic field, then you all of a sudden see that this single absorption line starts to spread out. And if you increase the magnetic field, you can even increase the spreading. This is a very interesting effect that was observed by the Zeeman guy. It's called Zeeman splitting. If I look at a single absorption line of an atom, and then I look at the same absorption line in the presence of a strong magnetic field, I can see that that single line starts to split up in multiple ones. And that was something people were really confused about for a while. Why is it that a single line in an atomic spectrum can split into multiple lines? You see that also with the hydrogen. Here, for example, is the Lyman alpha series, where you have a single line, but in the moment you put a magnetic field in there, you're starting to get split ups of them. So why is this? Let's look at the questions first before I answer. Do phosphorescence things eventually, no, we had that question before. You should show the levitating water droplet. Very cool way of seeing this. Maybe at the end of lecture, Jonathan, thanks for suggesting. Okay. I don't know, Joseph, what you meant with that, but it seems not understandable to me. Okay, good. So Zeeman effect says that a single line in the presence of a magnetic field, an absorption line in the presence of a magnetic field, splits up. And why is this? The answer to it is that the direction of angular momentum is also quantized. So angular momentum, being like this vector here, comes at a certain length. Certain lengths are only allowed. That is the magnitude of the angular momentum, but also the angles it can have with respect to a rotational axis. That is also quantized. And so you can see that an angular momentum that is orthogonal to a magnetic field here, that has the largest rotation, but as soon as it is in a different angle here, then this rotation, like the orbit that it spins around, is smaller. And this one here that has the smallest angle with regard to the z-axis, that is spinning on an even smaller one. And so because there are only discrete values allowed, I get a Zeeman splitting into a line corresponding to this angle, to this angle, to this one, to this one, and to this one. And there's one more question here. Oh, someone spilled on his keyboard. I'm sorry for that. All right. Quantization of angular momentum is something you would never see in real life. We only see it in physics, physics experiments. Here's a video of this ice dancer that you might have seen something like this in 105. This shows the conservation of angular momentum. You can see how she initially spins slowly while her arms are stretched out, but as she pulls her arms in, she spins up faster and faster. The reason for this is that angular momentum is conserved, and angular momentum is m, the mass, times the radius, times the velocity. And if she decreases the distance of her arms from her body, r gets smaller, but because the angular momentum l is conserved, she must spin faster. So her velocity v goes up and she rotates faster and faster until friction stops her. So the interesting thing now is that these values of L are quantized, the absolute values, but then also the radius, also the direction they take is quantized. It sort of means that this person, when she stretches out her arms, she could lower one arm and raise the other one up, so to create an angle. And she's only allowed to use specific angles for her arm, and she wouldn't have any way to, like, she would have to instantly jump from one angle to another. If you can picture what I'm thinking about, maybe I can draw it. So if you have the person, typically has her arms like this, but now she can also have her arms kind of like this, rising one arm up and one arm down. And quantization of angular momentum's direction means that this angle here, by which she raises one arm and lowers one arm, can only take very, very concrete values, can't be any arbitrary value. So that is the quantization of direction of angular momentum. The next thing we're going to look at is quantization of spin. Here's a nice video. I like it a lot. Maybe before we watch it, first the observation. So what's been observed is that when you take a single line in an atomic spectrum and you look very, 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 very precisely at it, you can see something that's called a fine structure. You can see that actually each of these lines is two lines. They have a very small energy difference between them, but they're distinctly two. And so each line is actually a doublet of two lines. And this experiment here shows kind of how it works. So we have a magnet here, North and South Pole, and now we're putting tiny little magnets in that have a certain orientation, like this one is oriented south to north, and when it flies through, it's going to get repelled and attracted, whoop, and dumps up there. Now we're going to throw one in that is orthogonal, it just travels straight through, and now one's flipped the other way around, and now a bunch of other ones, and after sending all of these little magnets through, we're going to see that they are able to end up on the screen in all possible orientations. If instead of using a magnet and sending it through, we would use a quantum object, which just means like a nucleus, some little electron, for example, we send this electron through. The electron will sometimes land on top and sometimes land at the bottom, but never in between. Electrons only land in two states and we give those guys names, we say those are two spin states. This one is spin up and this is spin down, because somehow these electrons, which are charged particles that are moving through a magnetic field, they're experiencing a Lorentz force. And depending on which way around these intrinsic spin angular momentum is pointing, it will either be pushed up or pushed down by the Lorentz force. And so because there are these two different outcomes, we are able to see that inside of a magnetic field, individual atomic spectral lines actually split up into a doublet corresponding to a spin up and a spin down. And for fermions, like electrons, there are exactly two states possible, spin up or spin down. All right, so now we learned all of the different quantum numbers. Now let's recap them once. So we learned that there's the principal energy level, which we call N. And this kind of tells us like what is the general energy that we're at. And those numbers can be 1, 2, 3, and so on. Then we saw that there's only certain values allowed for the orbital angular momentum. And those are defined by the small l, the angular momentum quantum number. And small l can take the values 0, 1, 2, 3, all the way up to the principal quantum number minus 1. Then we saw that there's a direction to the orbital angular momentum, which we call ML. And that kind of tells me, for a given angular momentum, how many different ways do I have to orient this angular momentum? How many angles are allowed? And I have between minus L and L options. If I'm in my first quantum state, my quantum number is 1, then I have only one angular momentum number, which is 0. I don't have angular momentum. And if I have 0 angular momentum, then I also have 0 options to put an angle into this. Okay. And then finally, the direction of the spin angular momentum, ms, is given as the number minus 1 and plus 1. So each individual quantum state can be split up into two substates, minus 1 and plus 1. And this now allows us to close the bridge to chemistry. When chemistry talks about the shell, what they actually mean is the principal quantum number n, where 1 corresponds to s, 2 to p, and 3 to d, and so on. The subshells, those are defined by the angular momentum L. And then we also have the orbitals. The orbitals are the mLs, and then of course the spins. So let's see where we stand with time. 5 minutes left, so let's quickly run through this example here. If I wonder how many possible states there are to a certain quantum number, I can ask myself, hey, if n equals 3, what are my options for L? Well, L can be 0, L can be 1, or L can be 2. L goes from 0 to n minus 1. And then what are my options for ML? How many directions can my L take? Well, if L equals 0, then I have only 0 options. So like, I have 0 options for ML. If L equals 1, then I have 3 options. I can be at minus 1, I can be at 0, or I can be at 1. And if it is 2, then I can be between minus 2, minus 1, 0, 1, and 2. And now each of these guys also has the chance to be an either up or down spin. So I have 2 options here, minus 1, plus 1. And I get plus and minus options for all of those. I don't want to draw this. So what I'm going to do is I jump onto the next slide where this picture is completed. So here you see the MS cases where everything is plus, minus 1, plus, minus 1. And now I can start thinking about chemistry. When chemistry talks about the s orbital, then my L is 0. And then down here, it tells me how many, so all of the states that are possible at the very end are electrons that can fit into an orbit, into a shell. So if I'm in the S shell, I'm able to fit one spin up and one spin down electron. So this is why my S shell only holds two electrons. When I look at P, where L equals one, then I can see here three states, so I end up with six possible options back here. And so this is the reason why I can put six electrons into the P shell. And on the D shell, I end up with 10 different possibilities for my electron. So in total, for an N equals three quantum system, I have 18 distinct states that can be filled by electrons. And it's very essential that you have distinct states, because distinct states give you at one point the different shells here. But distinct states are very important because they help us with avoiding the Pauli exclusion principle. So Wolfgang Pauli here, he came up with the statement that two electrons can never be sharing exactly the same address, the same quantum numbers. So if N, L, ML, and MS are exactly the same as in the case of these two electrons down here that are in the state N equals one and both spin up, they are not allowed to be in this state. There's a huge energy penalty on two electrons being this close to each other. They're completely repelling each other, and that would not be allowed. So it's verboten auf Deutsch. On the other hand, it's totally allowed to have different spin states, like spin up and spin down. And if you think about how the periodic table builds up, you actually start with a spin up, then you add a spin down, then your first shell is full, then you go into the second shell, you start filling with up and down, and you can put six more in this, or seven more in this, then five more in this, then you're at six, and then this P shell is full, and then you go to the next one, and so on. So very important to remember, Pauli exclusion principle says two electrons can never be exactly in the same state, and this gives rise to the periodic table. All right, while I'm putting up here our end of class survey, launch Paul. Okay, should be there. If you don't see it, click on the polling option. I'm going into the chat to see what questions were there. Isn't the MS plus minus one half? Yeah, so sometimes with the spin with fermions, we say that they have a half integer spin. I guess what I wanted to mainly point out here is that there are two different states. So, but you're right, we should say plus minus one half. All right, so we have everyone voted here. I guess we're at the end of this lecture. I will stick around for questions in the office hours. So if you have questions, feel free to use the chat. Otherwise, I'm going to see you next week.